we go. What do we see here, guys? What is going on? That is not wheat at all. I feel like I'm standing on Mars right now. What? Oh boy. I'll switch around here, guys. Let's see. Let me show you my face. 1 second. There we go. Oh, not quite. Almost there. One more. Come on, phone. Switch over. There. Hey, everyone. I'm not in Montana. You guys are wondering. I should probably take this mount off my phone. Let me take this long. Take my my mount off. I just got my live stream camera set up, so hang on a second here while I get everything going. This has been kind of a short notice stream. There we go. Perfect. I got my battery pack on. I got my external mic on. I'm hopefully not going to shake the phone too much. I've had a lot of coffee today, so my jittery. How's everyone doing? You guys are good? I think you can hear me okay, right? Audio should be like crystal clear. You guys should have, I have got my mic right here. Let me show you guys what I got. It's right here. See? That's my microphone. And it's directional, so when I talk like this, you guys can hear me real well. And when I turn it around the other way, see how much the sound drops off? It's a directional microphone. I like that because that way I can be in a noisy machine and you guys can hear my hideous voice. Awesome. All right, so we made a trip. We got an invite, guys. I'll go ahead and just tell you what's up. We've never been to any kind of factories, and I've never been out to Wisconsin. So I'm standing on Wisconsin soil right now, just out of Racine, Wisconsin. Case International headquarters is just down the road a little ways. And my brother, my dad, and myself, and a local representative, Gary, from Torgerson, was able to tag along with us. And just so happens, there is a 7250 right here. And that's a fully automated Case combine. So let me get out of that. There we go. Trying to run this thing. So yeah, so we got this machine and we're gonna play with it a little bit. Not only do I get to run a 7250 for the first time, so does Leg Arms, my dad. They're back here. There's Leg Arms right here. Trying to hold this phone steady. There we go. And we get to run this bad boy in corn, which we've never done. Hey guys, welcome to the channel. We got 917 of you. Nope, 1,000. Nice.
That's doing pretty good.
Yeah, what do you think, Leg Arms? You having fun today?
I'm having a lot of fun. This is neat. We've always been able to, always wanted to go see the whole operation of corn, and we've never gotten the chance. And
someone just called you a big goof. So this corn farm we're on runs about 7,000 acres. Is that what they said? 7,000 acres of dry land, mostly dry land corn. Yields are a little bit down this year. They had some issues with planting this spring. It was tough on them. And it's just been wet. They've been having a hard time getting in the field. You know, it's muddy. You can see the corn tires or the wheels, all the corn on it. I mean, that's an issue we don't deal with often on our operation. But they're getting in the corn now. But my dad is up in the combine right now with his name is Russ. And Russ is the Case combine guru. I'm told that guy can tell you every connection, bolt, nut, and any combine made from 1984 on up. Actually, I just made that number up. But no, he actually knows these combines very well. It's actually kind of an honor to cut with him because I sounds like that guy's got it figured out. He's been with these combines for years. There's my dad right here.
Hey.
He's in the picture. So let's look at this combine. Oh, yeah. There she is, 8250. So an 7250. Now 7250, guys, is a class 7 combine. This is not as big as that 8250 I was in. It's got a little less horsepower. When I talk to Russ, he could explain more about this machine and what's special about it. But yeah, it's quite a combine. Okay, Russ is taking off. He's gonna be back in a second. Oh, look at this baby. Isn't this awesome? Don't worry, guys. We're going to get a chance to run in a sec here. This is all kind of on the fly. So what's going on right now? It's hard to predict where we're going to end up. I'll start reading some comments here. Let's follow Leg Arms. He's got something figured out. What's that? You're going to teach everybody the corn lesson you just got? I missed out on the corn lesson, guys. Russ was explaining corn to Scott. Now, Scott. Okay. Got it. Let me change my camera here real quick. I'm going to change my camera one more time. There we go. Okay.
Okay. Here's the thing. I don't know the correct terms. This is what I was told. If I'm wrong.
Oh, here. Let me turn this microphone around real quick. Sorry. This mic, it's directional mic, guys. I got to flip around for Leg Arms.
There we go. Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yep.
All right. This is what I've been told. If I'm wrong about the terms and everything, I'm sorry. You can take your complaints up with Hollywood. But basically, it's kind of a neat concept. We've never actually seen this before.
So yeah, corn guys. Here we go, real quick.
Corn guys, you guys can just go ahead and plug your ears right now because this is not, this is like, we've never ridden a bicycle before. And everyone that's ridden a bicycle before is like, yeah, it's okay. So anyways, this is new to us corn guys.
Just to give a quick idea of this, you got the chains on both sides with the paddles here that grab the stalks, pull it in. You've got the augers right here that spin really, really, really fast, which goes down. And as the stalk come through, you've got these flat iron pieces that pinch the stalk and chop it off. So what you're trying to do is you're trying to leave the bottom of the corn here, take the top off, it goes inside the combine, takes the whole stalk or the corn cob itself off, and then it does its process. But compared to our headers, this is very foreign.
Now you can lift that up, right?
Yeah, they're supposed to be able to hit and adjust.
Okay.
But
and these headers are heavy. From what I understand, this is a 12 row, so this isn't a monster head. That's probably about the right size.
He also said too that they can speed up and slow down the header as it's going.
Wait, what's that? There's just so many combines. This is awesome.
So giddy. What's neat though is they can speed up and slow down that process of the header. So like on our Draper headers, they only go one speed all the time. You can't speed them up slow them down unless you get out and manually do it. But on the fly, this thing here, depending on what it wants, it'll vary the speed going back and forth. So that's pretty neat. But yeah, this is.
So this is like, is this sweet corn? Did he say it's a sweet corn?
I believe he did say it was sweet corn. We could be wrong though.
Corn.
And they said they're cutting about 20, 22 moisture roughly. Maybe it's hard to say exactly, but yeah, this is fun.
You guys asked where we are at. We're in Racine, R-A-C-I-N-E, Racine, Wisconsin. Just outside of Racine, actually, right now. We're out in some corn. This is Case International's headquarter. We got a chance to come out this way and experience some pretty cool places. We've never been to a factory before. Is that how he keeps those lips so smooth? Okay. Anyways, so we're in Racine, Wisconsin at the Case IH headquarters. We got to go and we just got done touring. It was awesome. Touring the Magnum plant.
I just can't tell you how excited it was. I mean, just, I wish I could play in their factory.
The machining equipment in there was amazing.
Millions of dollars that millions. I would love.
I think he said $380 million worth of machining equipment in that factory.
How big do you say the factory was?
84,000 square feet. This is the Magnum facility. And you guys can take tours of this place. They'll give you a VIP tour, basically. If you show up and set up, they'll take you out in the field. In the factory.
What's crazy is every 24 minutes, is that right? 24 minutes, a new tractor.
27.
Rolls 27.
Every 27 minutes and 30 some seconds.
Magnum tractor rolls off the line. Now, they do make the New Holland tractors and the Case tractors at the same plant.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool to see.
There was blue and red being produced. They try to do two an hour. So basically roughly 12 a day, I think, is what they shoot for. No, 18 a day.
Something like that. But they go nine hours a day and 5 days a week.
We had so many numbers thrown at us over the past couple hours here that I don't even know. It's like, here, guys, here's an 8250. Oh, wait, no, it's a 7250 because there's this number. But yeah, so that's what's going on. It's a real treat to us. It's been a blast here. I've never been to, I take that back. I've been to Wisconsin before. Oh, we got a donation. Love your videos. Doug Eddie. Thank you, Doug. I really appreciate it, man.
Hey, Nick.
Awesome of you. $5. What's that?
When you cut your chest hair, you got to throw it out.
That does look like
Doesn't it look like
Irish chest hair is what that is?
It's weird. It's like back hair, chest hair, that's the nose hair.
I don't know the technical term for that, but that's that fuzz on top of the corn husk, isn't it?
Something like that, yeah.
This soil here is amazing too. This is another thing that's kind of crazy is how dark this soil is. Our soil is like gray, brown. This is, ooh, what is that right there?
Okay, this right here is a full-size corn right there.
Look at the little baby corn.
No, no, it's full-size, Nick. It's full-size. Oh, okay. They don't get any bigger than this, okay?
Oh, they can't hear me. Yeah, sorry, this microphone is really bad.
I'm sorry, guys. This microphone's directional, so when I'm talking, I just need to let Scott talk. Okay, I'm just going to only talk when it's pointing at me.
There you go, Scott. Go ahead.
It's pretty good. It's really good. It's a lot better than wheat. It's more healthy. It doesn't have gluten. Really good for you. This is pretty impressive, though.
And again, someone donated $5, said thanks for the videos. Appreciate it, man. That's awesome. I got to get used to this new microphone. When I turn it, I got to make sure it's pointed at the guy talking. So, yeah, that's why if you guys don't hear me, it's probably because I'm talking to a microphone that's pointed the wrong direction.
Okay, so what else should we talk about?
I don't know. You want to climb over the back of this thing?
Let's go look in the grain tank.
So a 7250, guys, we'll have more explanation here in a second. A 7250 is, this combine is going for sale next year. You can buy these, you can put in pre-orders right now for them. It's a full automation combine. It's just like the 8250 that I was in.
Sorry, microphone again. I just can't get used to that.
Let me hold it for you so you can, talk.
There's a bunch of donations real quick.
Here, I'm going to switch the camera around. Let me just flip my mic around. We'll just do sorry, guys. I'm getting used to this new hardware here. This is my first live stream with all this hardware, so. Okay, there we go. There, that's better. Now you guys can hear me. I just keep talking to nothingness. I got a couple donations. I just want to reach out to these guys. Nils Berg, Norwegian, $50. Thank you. Greetings from Norway. I love your videos. Been here since 40K. Thank you. That's awesome. We got $5 from Anthony Krukowski. Krukowski, that's awesome. That's isn't that a football player's last name? $5.
Come on.
Sorry, I got to get up here. $5. Thank you, man. One more. $2.79 Canadian. Are you guys gonna stop by and visit How Farms Work? Oh, is he from this area? That'd be sweet. Okay, let's climb up this ladder. I'm gonna go up this thing. Just folded it down on me here.
Oh, here he comes. Let's get a nice view of the.
All right, guys, I'm gonna show you guys. Here's Russ. That's the Combine Guru right there. He just walks like he's a Combine expert.
Dude, that is a stride of success.
That guy's adjusted probably a couple thousand Combines in his time.
He's going to be so angry at us for not knowing anything.
There's a nice Case Steiger there unloading in some corn. I believe Pops is in that Combine right there cruising. I guess Hal Farms Work is right in this area,
really?
Like 3 hours away.
We better get down. He's wanting us.
Okay. Yeah, here's some corn in here. That's a weird look in here. It looks like candy corn. That's awesome. All right. Okay, we'll get down.
Get the ladder.
Okay, we'll go down.
Ride with him first.
And down we go. You sure you don't want to sit on my lap, Scott?
I could.
All right, Russ. Okay, so everybody real quick, this is Russ.
Hey, everybody.
Russ is the combine expert. he's out on this. This isn't your farm, but you're related to these guys on the farm, right?
Next door neighbors for 40 years.
40
so
years.
We've worked together a long time. They're a great Case IH customer, and we help them out, and they help us out with things like this.
Awesome.
It works real well for us.
And it's also convenient you were able to get the 7250 out here, too.
Absolutely.
What do you think of it?
It's a nice machine.
How many years have you been able to play with this thing?
I personally have not been playing with it except for the last month or so.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
so this is new to you?
This is very new to me, right.
Oh, okay.
So we're in I'm the product support guy. So we're at the final phases of launch on these machines.
Okay.
And so now it's my turn to take it from the engineering staff and all the guys that did all the design and the marketing people, and now learn about it to make sure that we can support it once it goes into the hands of the customers.
That makes good sense. Yeah. Right. So how many hours are on this particular machine?
Probably 25 or 30.
25 or 30 hours. So it's pretty fresh.
It's pretty fresh. We were able to harvest some soybeans with it earlier this year. We've had some tough weather.
Yes.
We had some
good weather the last couple of weeks, so we were able to get out with it and cut some soybeans, but you can see it's a little damp. In fact, we almost got stuck with this machine. It's only it's not a power guide axle machine, it's two-wheel drive. So
what's the horsepower on a 7250?
It's going to be in the 440 max,
so that's close to an 8230 then.
Well, 8230 is going to be similar.
Now, this has the 9 liter.
No, this has an 11 liter.
Oh, it does have 11.
That's correct. So we switched from the 9 liter to the 11 liter in the 7240s.
Okay.
We did.
Correct. So a 7230 would have a 9 liter, and all the Class 7s prior to that would have the 9 liter.
So it's the same as the 8 and 9 now, series, the same motor.
No. This Class 7 has an 11 liter.
Okay.
And then the 8s have a 13 liter. And then the 9s have a 16 liter.
Okay.
And that all happened at the 240 series combines.
Okay.
So our cooperators are running 7240s.
Okay, they have 40s.
They will have the same engine as this.
Okay.
And same horsepower.
So I don't know. I haven't had a chance to have someone explain to me and show kind of where. Is there things we can look at that show some of the automation sensors on here and things?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Awesome. Okay, let me flip this mic around real quick and we'll switch the camera and Russ here can give us a quick brief down on how this thing works.
Run down.
Okay. It's so funny to see them out of the cars.
And we had lots more mud not too long ago. We're a little bit less than that. All right. It's going to be hard for, you may have to come up in here, but right on the side here, we have our rotor loss sensors.
Okay.
And so that's going to be something that we watch. We do that normally with all the combines, but for automation, that's going to be very important.
So is it the same system just tied into the automation?
Correct. Okay. That's exactly right.
All right.
Yep. The other thing that we have up in here, if you look right up in here, we've got the cage vane adjustments.
Oh, that's how they do it.
That's right.
Is that an electronic actuator?
It's an electric actuator, and it's on a linkage, and the back six vanes are tied together, and we move all six vanes back
and forth.
Now,
what about the front vanes?
The front two are manual, just like any other axial flow combine, and you can adjust them if you want. They are currently fixed in the mid position. You can make them fast or slow if you thought that would improve your threshing or separating.
So how many vanes total is there then?
There's eight now. There were nine.
Now, why did you guys go down to eight?
Just find that the real estate necessary in the top of the cage, in order to make this gang change together, it worked out better to have the six gang together instead of trying to do the nine again.
Now, do you have the same, you don't call them concaves, you call them?
Rotor modules.
Modules. Are they all the same all the way to the front, or do you have different stages on the corn?
Okay, so on this machine, we call them rotor modules, but lefts are lefts and rights are rights. So we have the same modules for the lefts and for the rights, but you can't switch them side for side. But you can move all the way front to back. So the same module that fits in the number one row will fit in the number four row as long as it's on the left side of the vehicle.
Okay.
Same thing on the right side. So that's why I say lefts are lefts and rights are rights, but front to back, it's no different.
But is the spacing the same all the way through? Like,
okay,
yep.
We have many different modules available. So we've got, you know, hard thresh, small wire, large wire. On this particular combine, we are set up with large wire in the front and large skips in the back.
Okay.
And that's a typical corn soybean setup for us. A lot of people also use round bars, and the round bars don't have any edge to them. It is literally a round bar.
If that volume's too loud, guys, I have it turned up right now. So
it is,
let me know if it sounds good.
They really are a bar, and we usually use that in corn if the shredding of the leaves or the mog or the material other than grain that's going through the machine, if that's shredding too much, then we'll put round bars in.
Okay, and then you're running the rotor at, you said 300?
Yeah, it's somewhere around 360, 370.
Okay.
That's a little slow probably for most corn harvests, but this corn is really dry, which is unusual for us. We're very happy that we have dry corn because then we don't have to pay so much to dry it down.
Yep.
Long-term storage for us, we need it down to about 14. Sale moisture is 15.5. So this corn's running about 19, 18.5, somewhere in there. So we have to take a few points out of it. Not unusual for us on the 2nd of November to be harvesting 23, 24% corn and having to dry that down. But this is really nice conditions from that standpoint.
So the vanes are adjusting on them with the automation.
That's correct.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yep. Okay. And then we're gonna have to go.
I'll put that up for you.
Yep. Pretty good.
So guys, the you have to have grain loss sensors. For those that don't know how it works, grain loss sensors are basically sensors that determine when grain isn't getting into your tank. It's either kicked out by your rotor or your separation area. But you have to have that so that the combine can adjust itself, because if it needs to know if it's losing grain out the back,
then it's going to change settings, and that's what
Russ can explain here how it does. And those vanes are one of the settings that changes.
Okay, and then the other is the Sivloss sensor, which is a silver pan across the top there.
Okay.
Okay, and then as far as cleaning system goes, it will automatically adjust the cleaning fan speed. It'll adjust the pre-sieve, which is the one at the front. It'll adjust the top sieve and the bottom sieve. And those are all electric actuators that are going to do that for us. So okay. They'll open and close them as necessary to improve the sample.
Okay. Now, what about the chopper? Are you using the chopper to chop the corn?
No, in corn, we do no particle size reduction in corn. Okay, so we are on the slow side with the chopper, and we have the counter knife out. In fact, when you plug a corn head in, if it sees that the counter knives are in, it will give you an alarm and tell you to check your chopper counter knife and get it out.
Oh, okay.
So no particle size reduction. This is just way too tough to try to chop.
And you are spreading it as you're going. You're not just dropping
it. Right. Okay. But we want it to be just like any other head. You want it to be spread out the same width. So really, we've got our spreader set at the slowest speed and the narrowest possible width because the cobs fly. You'll see them.
From the cab, can you adjust your spread?
We can on this machine because this machine is equipped with the in-cab spreader controls. Not all machines, that's an option, so not all machines would have that.
Okay. And that's with all 50 series, they're having that option, right? Or is this an option you can buy?
It's an option you can buy.
Okay.
Yep. And you could have bought it on for any series, 20 series, 10 series.
Okay.
Now, how many times is it, so many times per second it takes samples? And or is it just a constant feed as data's coming in, it's constantly adjusting?
It's a constant feed, but we have three settings that the operator can choose.
Okay.
We have a slow, medium, and fast settings. So how often do you want it to make those adjustments?
Oh, okay.
And so it takes a bunch of readings and it makes adjustments either more frequently or less frequently. Okay. So there's actually a frequency adjustment that you can set. So if you got a field that is very consistent, you wouldn't necessarily need a high frequency of adjustment. Okay. But if you had a field that had a lot of variances in it, then you might want to increase the frequency and make the system react a little bit quicker.
Okay.
Now, what about the sieve and chopper? Do you guys only have one, or do you run both on corn?
Corn's both.
Both. You do run both.
Right. So we have a pre-sieve, an upper sieve, and a lower sieve. And we have different variations of that. So the pre-sieve can be inch and an eighth, inch and five-eighths closed slat, or inch and an eighth, or inch and five-eighths corn, which is a big, thick finger one for high capacity.
Now, what about your fan? What do you run for your fan?
About 980 to 1,000.
Okay.
Somewhere in that neighborhood.
Okay.
So we're just trying to blow all this stuff out. Really, what we're trying to blow out is the silks. So when you look on an ear of corn, there's the silks on the top. So that's really what's going on. All right, so Nick, I'm going to have you step up here.
Yes, sir.
And look inside, and you're looking at this device right in here.
Okay, so he's telling me to look at a device right here. Oh, there it is.
Let me take this real quick.
And so that's on the clean grain elevator.
Right, and that is your grain camera.
Grain camera.
Grain camera, right there.
Okay.
And what we're doing is we're looking at the grain as it goes up the clean grain elevator.
Okay.
And we're looking at it for cracks and brokens, and we're looking at it for material other than grain.
Is it an actual camera?
It's an actual camera.
And so the computer analyzes the imagery. Is there like a light in there?
There are.
Or is it an infrared camera?
It's a four different light wave camera. So we use four different types of light in order to get the image that we need in order to do the processing.
That's amazing.
Yep.
Does it get dirty?
It does get dirty, and on Keon, if it sees it's dirty, it will give you the alarm and tell you to come and clean it.
How do you clean it? Is there just a cover or something that comes off?
No, you just swing it out. So you see this?
I see.
You just pull it up and out, and this will swing open. We can take it off completely for service if we needed to. It's just plugged in down here.
Okay.
And we can take it
and
off.
And then it's just basically wipe the lens and put it back on?
Yeah, just like with any glass cleaner.
How often do you have to clean that?
So far, I've never had to clean this one.
Really?
That's right.
So it has to get pretty bad for it, too.
Yeah.
So it has to probably be certain crops are probably dirtier than others.
Yeah, but... and obviously the moisture level, you know, and what's going up the clean grain elevator would have an effect on that.
Here's a question. Okay, so say this system goes out. Does that eliminate the entire automation of the combine?
Wouldn't eliminate all of it because we're using many different sensors.
Okay.
That would certainly eliminate our ability to make adjustments for cracks and brokens, and it would eliminate our ability to make adjustments for moss.
So it'll keep adjusting for loss and for other...
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
Oh, that's cool.
So now what happens if, like, some reason you want to get gut, there's a storm coming in, and the automation system's kind of running, can you turn that all off and just keep gutting?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yep. And you can manually adjust
that. That's right.
Okay.
Now, one of the modes that we have for both feed rate control, which is controlling the speed of the combine, and for automation is maximum throughput. So if you set it for maximum throughput, you basically are telling the combine, okay, we realize that you would do something different with losses and you would do something with grain quality, but today I got to go. So give me maximum throughput. You set your parameters for speed. So, you know, your headers can only cut and gather at such a rate. And engine load, you want to only run at a certain amount of engine load. And then what you want to do, once you do that, then it will take you right on up to whatever the limiting factor is.
Okay.
So if your limiting factor is engine load, it'll pull you back when you get to the engine load.
We're going to start this thing up in a second, guys. I'm learning things here too, so I haven't had this briefing yet. So he's explaining stuff to me that I didn't know. So yeah, hang on, we'll get there.
Shaker pan in the front.
Okay.
Yeah, the shaker pan is from here forward.
Okay.
And then there's a preset, and an upper sieve and a lower sieve.
Oh yes, okay. So the whole pan is the shaker. Oh
yep.
I was thinking that there was two sections then.
No. And then the whole pan will self level.
Now how many degrees will it start to level to?
I think this one is at 12%.
So that's pretty aggressive.
Yeah, something like that. Okay. Don't hold me to the marketing numbers.
Yeah, well, I might just.
That's okay.
If you give me a suit like yours, I won't hold it against you.
People are always correcting me on YouTube. Constantly.
So those are the specifications I can look up.
Awesome.
Okay. So.
Okay.
I just, my job is to keep them running. So.
Wow.
And we're holding you.
Yeah, that's important. Not at all. No, this is awesome. This is great. Okay, one other sensor we have is we have a tailings volume sensor. And you notice down here we've got a couple of pieces to it. And this is shooting a light wave across the tailings. So as the tailings impeller comes around, it's going to break that light beam. And when it breaks that light beam with nothing on the paddle, it's a very short frequency of break. And as the volume on the paddle increases, then the light will be broken for a longer time. And then we know that the tailings is going up. And that will also be factored into the
So when you say
equation.
A light beam, does it shoot across from the other
Shoots
side?
Shoots across, right. So we have a transmitter
okay,
and a receiver.
Oh, so you have to have two to go
Yeah, we have
other.
Two that go
so
across.
It's like a garage door. Like
Absolutely.
The same exact concept.
Same
okay.
concept. You got it.
Okay, so kids, when you try to run underneath there, it'll stop it.
Yeah.
So we're good.
That's right. Yep. So that's the long and the short. But, you know, we're also going to use the ground drive hydro.
Okay.
We're going to measure the engine load. We're going to measure the ground drive hydro load by measuring the drive pressure and the flow, and we're going to use that to add to the equation, and that way we know when we're bumping up against our limits for ground drive consumption on the power, when we bump up against the engine load for power, and then once we get up against those, if that's going to be our limiting factor, then we'll back out of it.
Okay.
Now, in corn, this machine, 8-row head, we're nowhere close to the capacity of this machine.
Okay.
Nowhere close.
Well, it's only an 8-row head?
8-row
oh,
head.
Oh, okay.
What's the biggest head you can get?
16. 18-row narrow. So 18-row 20 right now.
Okay.
Yep. That's from
Pace. And you were telling us earlier, the spacings that are most common that people use for corn, because a lot of these guys don't know. Like,
right. Yeah, so these rows are planted 30 inches apart, and that's a very common spacing in the Midwest.
Okay.
This particular farm that we're on, they have a Case IH 16-row 31 splitter planter. So they plant all their soybeans in 15-inch rows, and they plant all their corn in 30-inch rows with the same planter. And the difference between a planter and a seeder is a planter singulates the seeds and drops them in at a very specific rate, as opposed to like an air seeder where you're kind of just putting a big stream out there.
Okay.
So the seeders are streaming the seed and the planters are singulating the seed and dropping
what
it.
What was this planted? Do you know?
I do not know the population. Roughly 30,000.
Okay.
Right. Roughly 30,000 plants per acre. So, yeah.
And how fast are you cutting right now?
We're cutting at about 4.5.
Okay.
We've got some undulations in here. The machines are certainly capable of going much faster than that, but you have to be able to stay on the corn rows.
Yeah.
Well,
I suppose
true. How about we not talk too much? Let's run the machine.
Yeah, let's fire her up.
Go ahead and take them in there,
yep.
And
okay.
I'll watch you guys from the distance.
Yeah, actually, if you just walk over there, we're going to come out.
Okay, I'm going to switch the camera on you guys real quick. Hang on a sec here. Well, appreciate the explanation, Russ. You can hang on to it. I think I can hold this in my hand. I'm pretty good at holding cameras in my hand. There we go. Okay, front facing cams on. All right, guys, I'm back. So Russ is climbing up on in. I'm going to follow behind. We're going to fire this beast up and we're going to cut some corn. I've never cut corn before. This is exciting stuff. Oh, she's horn ready. Okay. All right. Okay. So,
Now, is this the only farm this has been on in the area here?
No, we've had the machine out with three or four different cooperators.
Okay.
Since I've lived in the area for so long, I know all the growers.
Yeah, well, and you're this close to the area. That makes sense.
Yes.
Get a chance to run this.
I've worked with all the growers in a variety of capacities over the years. So.
Okay.
It's very nice that we can get the cooperators to let us come out and use our equipment. And I'm a trainer, so my job is to train all of our product support team. And our product support team needs the ability to go out and run a machine, and that's what we're doing for this one.
Okay. There comes a nice little truck right there. So where are they hauling this corn to? Are they binning it then?
Yeah, so they this particular cooperator has many locations where they dump grain.
Okay.
And they have their own drying facilities at three locations that they're using right now.
Okay.
And so it's a three-ring circus, and that's the big logistics of corn is trying to figure out where to go with the corn, especially in an operation like this where we are dumping grain in three locations.
Okay, yeah, that would be. Now, this corn was planted in April or May?
May.
May, okay.
It's pretty rare for us to do much in April, maybe towards the end of April, but certainly early May. And May is our big month for planting. And then we like to get everything in, obviously, in mid-May. We got rained out this year, so we got some in early and then sat and waited. And got the rest of it in a little bit later, but everything ripened up. We were behind quite dramatically here. About a month ago, we were way behind. We've had 10 inches more rain this season than normal.
10 inches, wow.
Yeah, so we're over. And so the subsoil is really wet. And because of that, when we get any little shower, then the top gets wet too.
Okay.
That's kind of what we're up against here. In fact, we were trying to pick in this area earlier today, and we got stuck pretty bad. I guess we didn't get technically stuck, but we weren't able to do much.
Yeah, it's been a little squirrely.
So we decided to...
I see Pops in that combine.
Yep, he's with Eric, and Eric's
okay.
The other part of the operation. So Don and Eric are cousins, and then Don's brother Kevin, and Eric's nephew Trevor.
Okay.
So it's a family affair, and they've got lots of good help.
Awesome.
From the neighborhood, so.
Well, we've got almost 1,400 people watching us right now.
That's good.
People are enjoying it. Everyone's really excited to cut some corn. So we're getting to it, guys. We're getting to it. Oh, we got a field over here.
Yeah, so we're going over the hill because this one over here is lots drier. So
we have three cases right now?
Yep, we got two 7240s running Abro Geringhoffs, and we have the 7250 running Abro Case H 4408.
And are
30-inch.
Are those two the customer's combines?
They are,
okay,
yes.
Okay, for the landowner?
Yep, and this is their third set of axial flows. They were a John Deere farm for many, many years.
In fact, oh, really?
They still have one John Deere that Dad runs.
Oh, okay.
And then they decided that the technology and the axial flow was what was the best thing for them. And
okay.
So they bought 7120s the first time, 7230s, and now 7240s.
Do they trade them every year or two?
No, not... No,
that's a beautiful place too, by the way. Love that barn.
Not on any tight schedule.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I think they're...
You said 7,000 acres?
Yeah, about 7,000 acres.
And that's all corn and soybean?
And wheat.
And wheat, okay.
Yeah, corn, soybeans, and wheat. And then with their wheat, they do baler straw. We have an excellent market for straw.
Well, that's a lot of product to go through three machines.
Yes.
So, yeah, that's...
All right, we're going to follow these guys on it. Sure which way he's going to go this week.
Okay. So that's the 40. Now the 40, oh, is that Gary in there? Yeah, that's Gary. The 40, is the engine and emissions on the 40 the same as this one?
Yes, they're both Tier 4B emissions using full SCR.
Full SCR, okay.
Yep.
Okay. Got it. So the difference between these two, basically, this one's got automation built into it.
Correct. And a different ground drive system.
Oh.
So.
Ground drive. You were talking about that.
So we have a two-speed ground drive transmission in this one.
Oh.
And that has the four-speed ground drive transmission.
Because when I got to drive that 8250, I was impressed by being able to go up to 12 miles an hour without having to switch gears in my cutting gear.
Absolutely.
And that I thought was pretty neat because it seemed like you're always just a couple mile an hour slower where you want to be.
Correct.
It's a little greasy here. You can see some tire tracks there.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that orange piece over there, and that's a drainage inlet.
Okay.
So the water will collect into that, drop into that orange riser, we call them, and down into a tile, and we're heading down. Everything down in the bottom here, that's the beginning of the Des Plaines River.
Oh, okay.
So the Des Plaines River.
So that's where the drainage goes.
Right.
Got it.
This is the Des Plaines River Valley, really.
Okay.
Okay, and so we pick from the inside always because we want our load tubes out because the grain cart's got to come and get us.
Okay.
Because we fill the grain tank rather rapidly, even with eight-row corn heads.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So we're in over 200 bushel per acre crop here.
Oh, good.
And
that's amazing.
Yes.
I know that's not necessarily record corn, but that is just, those numbers are just hard to fathom.
It is. And even for us, historically, you know, we're creeping up above the 200s now. And, you know, 10 years ago, we would have been not that high.
Do you think it's because of varieties?
It is definitely varieties.
Genetics.
Planters, you know, everything that has to do with it. All right. So what I'm doing is I'm watching my snouts go between the rows. And I got to make sure that I'm on the row. And I got to make sure that my divider points are low enough to get under the corn and lift it up, and then because of that, then we'll get them into the corn head, and you see how it's stripping the ears off.
That's cool.
And then we'll, and we are running automatic header height control, so it's following the ground contours.
So see his, down. He's in automation right now, guys. You can see his hands off the controls here. I see I got a bunch of donations from you guys. I'll get to that in a minute, so if you guys are still watching, hang on.
So you see how the corn is laying over and the divider points go right underneath it?
Oh, yeah.
It stands it up.
Well, that's neat. Is that pretty typical for corn to be laying over like that?
We'd hope not, but it can be.
Okay. So that's, well, out in our wheat country, we have soft flies.
Yeah.
And we're used to picking stuff off on the ground, so. Yeah.
So we'd like to be here a little sooner than this, but
the weather,
you know, the weather, it's an unpredictable business.
So how tall are some of these stalks here? Are we looking
Probably 10, 11 feet.
Is that pretty typical?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
That is amazing how much plant is out there.
Yeah. And I think picking corn is one of the most amazing transformations because, you know, you're obviously got all this in front of you, and then next to you, it's just gone. And you see the grain coming
at
a very high rate of speed.
So what's the monitor say right now for yield?
About 246.
246 bushels an acre right now going in the hopper. And they've got two grain or combine chasers, grain carts.
Yep, two grain carts, an 1100 bushel and a 750 bushel.
Okay.
Because we got three machines going.
No, oh, yeah.
They pick with two.
It's a lot to keep up with.
Yeah, but we added a third one. And so I need to slow down through these dips.
Yeah, that's the one thing. That's the one thing automation can't see is the terrain to the ground.
Correct. That's right.
Maybe someday, but right now.
And we like to pick at about 4.5 miles an hour. If we go too fast in this down corn, if we flip the corn up, the ears will literally be flung off the stalks.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So you do have to be a little bit careful and not overdo it.
Yep.
Now, but the combine itself has way more power and way more capacity.
Okay.
As far as engine load goes, we're only using 80% right now.
80, yeah.
And that's even pulling up this hill in these wet conditions. So, you know, there's way more combine left, but you still have to do a good job of cutting and gathering no matter what you're doing. So,
see, we ran this last year 2588s.
Yep.
So we haven't really had much time in the flagships yet. So the whole engine load and running your combine according to that is new to us. I knew that that's what they're doing, but so it's going to be a learning curve. There's that corn covering that window. Not nice. Oh boy. So do we have any questions from you guys for Russ and the machine here? I'm sure you'd gladly answer you guys. Here, I'll get a shot of that monitor right there.
Yep, so there's our combine cutaway.
So you guys can see right there as it's changing the numbers, you got your rotor speed, your fan speed, your vane position, it's got your pre-sieve. What are the sieves again? There's
pre-sieve, upper sieve, and lower sieve.
Pre-sieve, upper sieve, lower sieve. And they're all adjusting on the fly as this combine's pulling this product through to maximize grain loss, efficiency.
They just switched drivers. He's going to get his first chance to pick corn.
Oh, is Gary going to run that thing?
Yes, he is.
Yeah, he's kind of addicted to corn cutting. Oh yeah. This is fun. I have never been in a combine cut corn before. I've never stood in a cornfield. I think when I was a little kid, I stood in a cornfield. But this is new territory for me. I know this is pretty
unique compared to where you guys live, and yeah. This is what the Midwest is all about.
Well, it makes sense.
Corn and soybeans, and the big difference here is we get the water.
If we could grow this,
yeah,
I think we would. Yeah, yeah. There are actually some dry land corn in Montana.
Yep.
But I mean, you're looking at 100 to 150 an acre, maybe if you're lucky.
Sure.
Some irrigated, I think, can get up to that, close to maybe 200, but that's just a few select areas. Oh, this is cool. The noise is different too. You can hear those husks and the.
It's actually the cobs.
Okay.
The cobs make a lot of noise as they go through the machine. And they're pretty, you know, they're pretty dense and hard on the outside. Obviously, the corn comes off the cob fairly easily, but you can see the corn bubbling up in the front up there.
Oh, yeah.
Filling them. And that's, so you can, you really now are getting a good look at the speed at which they must be on a full tank. So they're going to wait for the cars. So they'll just sit here and wait with them too.
Okay. Yeah. And I don't know, has Case priced these units yet?
I'm sure they have.
Okay.
I'm not your dealer salesperson.
Oh, you are?
No, I'm not.
Oh, you're not.
I'm not the dealer salesperson.
So I can't ask, okay, what this machine would cost?
No clue.
All right. I don't know either, guys.
I live in a perfect world.
Yeah.
Where all the machines are fairly new.
I'm sure it's pretty close to what prices are for a new machine today. So.
I'm sure, yeah.
Yeah, it's probably in that ballpark.
Yep.
How fast can you, wait, question, in perfect conditions, how fast can you shell corn?
Probably 6 or 7 miles an hour.
6 or 7 miles an hour?
Yeah.
Okay.
At 6 or 7 miles an hour, the header speed maxes out and you can't process the stalks appropriately.
Okay. Oh, here's a question for you. This is kind of, so like right now we're stopped. We're not cutting corn.
Yep.
Do you just like to leave the separator engaged?
I do.
Like even when you're dumping on the go, like say you're pulling out of the field, there's a truck parked.
Yeah.
I always grew up, I turn it off, I pull up, dump, I throttle back, engage auger, throttle up, throttle down, go back to the field, engage separator, throttle up and go. Is that a wear and tear on your engaging systems? Is it better to just...
Half a dozen either way.
Okay.
So for you guys, when you're unloading into the trucks,
okay,
that's fine.
Okay.
Throttle down. On your 2588s, one of the worst things you can do is shut the separator off at high idle. Because the
high idle, yeah, okay.
Right. Because the, that is very difficult on the rotor drive.
And so, I've done that honestly. Because I've ran those things.
Everybody has. Now the reason I didn't shut it off this time,
yeah,
is because I knew the cart would be coming rather quickly.
Okay.
And so by the time we shut it down and turn it back on, and then get going again, so you see the carts ahead of us there,
yeah,
and off they go. So
and
that's
these,
why I just hung out here for a while.
These flagships use a transmission to engage the rotor, or to power the rotor, correct?
That's correct. We use a CVT.
So is there a clutch pack that engages and disengages when
yes.
you flick the switch?
Yeah, there's each of the CVTs have a couple of clutch packs. One is to hold it from moving and to allow us to use the rotor reverser.
Okay.
And the other one is to connect it to the engine.
Okay.
So they've got some real catchy names. One is called an engine to ring.
Okay.
It's called a ring to frame, but those are the two clutches that are in your CVT that run it. Now, when you engage your rotor, what we do is we use all hydraulic drag to just start the rotor, and once it matches engine speed, we do a clutch swap, so we're not hard on the clutches at all.
Okay.
When we're engaging the rotor. And then that second, that first clutch swap will connect it to the engine, and then we're going to be at engine speed, and then we're going to use hydraulic pump and motor to get you to the exact speed that you're looking for.
Okay, that makes sense. I'll look to my other camera here. Okay.
CVT, a lot of people think it's a mystery, but a CVT is actually a fairly simple mechanical planetary gear set. So,
this combine has an FPT engine. Yes, it does.
Yes, it does. Yep.
Iveco? Or, yeah.
Well, originally known as Iveco engines, but
they rebranded or
rebranded
something.
Rebranded as FPT. Fiat Powertrain Technology.
Got it. Is automation becoming a standard? I'm sure everybody else is trying to get in that field.
Oh, as far as other brands?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely.
As far as Case goes, yes, this is the direction we're going. Can you buy a combine in 2019 that's not automated?
Yes, you can.
Okay, so it's an option.
It's an option.
Right? Okay, got it. How many bushels an acre? We're running a little over 200?
Yeah, is that 245 up here on the hill.
245, right?
Right up there.
And you like to run yield dry on your numbers?
I do,
okay.
Yes.
That's usually what I run to.
Yep.
Um, Case makes an 8250. They also make a 9250.
Correct.
Here's our cart. We got a John Deere 8110 with a JM Manufacturing 750 grain cart. And we are getting pretty full of corn here. Oh, there's the auger. Don't worry, it's not like if you mess up, there's 1,200 people watching or anything. Spill corn everywhere. Well,
that's okay. Those 1,200 don't matter. The embarrassment of my fellow workers in the field is way more than those 1,200.
Yeah.
Some sort of fermented malt beverage that is given to the operator that gets something over or gets something stuck.
They're all taking notes right now how to give Russ a hard time when they get off the comic.
And you're riding with an occasional operator. So I don't do this all day every day. I do this occasionally. My main focus is to make sure everybody knows how to fix things.
Let's see here. Is the combine coming out next year? Yes, it is.
Actually, they're shipping them right now.
Oh, they're shipping them right now. Okay.
Yep.
What is the average life expectancy of this machine? Well, probably for the combine itself, it's probably very standard.
Yeah, so depends on the use, obviously. So it's a really hard question to answer.
Yeah.
So
there's so many variables that go into that.
That's correct, yes.
Okay.
But, you know, 5 to 10 years, and then there'd be a second life for it for an operator that would not use it as hard. And we've got many, many axle flows that are out there that are from 1976, 77.
There's some around us that are still going. Yeah. Okay. What other questions you guys got? I saw, why is the rear tire, where was that at? Why is the rear tires put backwards on a two-wheel drive combine?
So that the cleats will clear.
Oh, is that why? It cleans the cleats, the tread out. Oh. Right.
Because we're dragging it. We don't have power. We don't want them to bite. If they bite, they'll mud up, and then we're dragging mud.
Oh, I've never.
We don't want to drag the mud. We want it to help steer the machine.
That's a good question. That's actually something I've always wondered, too. Let's see here. What time is sunrise over here? Probably what?
7:18. 7:20.
7:20.
Until we go to standard time over the weekend.
Okay. Yep.
I guess
right.
It's still it's. Not
a, yeah, Montana does change. We're not. Is Arizona the only state that doesn't change? I think one of those guys is.
That's right.
Let's see here. Any more questions for you guys for this thing? You got the combine guy. How many liters is the motor?
11 liters.
11-liter engine. Okay.
So in the class 7, we use an 11-liter engine. In the class 8, we use a 13-liter. And in the class 9, we use a 16-liter.
Okay. Oh wow, 16 in the class
16,
9. Is that new?
That came out with the 9240s.
Oh.
So model year 15.
And what kind of horsepower can that max out?
625.
Oh. That's amazing. Yep. Wow. That's a massive engine. See, we've got some old Big Buds, and they've got 1150 cubic inches, which is, I think, a 19-liter engine. And I always thought that was as big as you're going to see, but at 16, they're not getting far away from that. Won't be long. You'll be seeing that. Machines. Yep. That's amazing. How much does this cost? We got asked that earlier. Not sure yet, guys. What is your fuel consumption per hour?
You know what? I don't even know off the top of my head here. So let's see if we can find it.
He's going to take a look and see if he can find it.
Let's see if we can find it here. Let's try that. I don't know if I can even find
it. It's on there somewhere. Yeah, it's buried in the system. This combine's only got like 30 hours on it, so they've hardly had a chance to really run it. Oh, it says 55 engine hours on it.
Fuel rate, 15 gallons an hour.
So you're looking at 15 gallons an hour right there. You guys can see that.
And we're not really taxing the machine.
Okay.
With an 8-row corn head and and again, it's all about making sure we do a good job of cutting and gathering, staying on the roads, etc.
See, now I know this would be optimum for Case as a company, but if I were a farm and I ran multiple machines, to me it would make sense to have one automated combine in the fleet. And that they're all the same class, and then I could say, hey guys, my automation is doing this right now, change your combines to these settings, and then
absolutely.
They could go out manually and change it.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's if you didn't want to do all of automation or couldn't afford the automation, but that way if you had like 90 or some like 72 30s or 40s maybe.
The big advantage to automation is there are a lot of excellent operators, and even the most excellent operator will not make
changes as frequently as this thing will as it goes across the field.
You can't. There's too many things to be paying attention.
That's right. Yeah. We're trying to stay on the row. We're trying to dump into the cart. You know, we're watching to make sure we don't hit anything. We're trying to keep from getting stuck.
Yeah.
You know, we're watching the grain tanks. Then we're, you know, taking a look at the sample, that sort of thing. And to make all those changes as quick as the automation can is really difficult.
Yeah.
So, you know, most of us that operate are looking for, you know, a good average. We'll maybe make changes, you know, after the morning dew comes off, because we can pick corn with a little dew on it as long as the silks are dry.
Okay.
And then if it gets really dry during the day, we might have to make a change. And then if the dew comes on at night, we might have to make a change again.
Now, I noticed your hand steering this. Someone mentioned, are you running GPS auto steer?
Yeah, and
is the reason for it, you're not doing auto steering this?
When you pick corn, you need what they call row guidance, and this particular machine is not currently equipped with row guidance.
Okay.
So even if you are on RTK steering, the planter will drift a little bit, and we're trying to stay right on the row. And so if I were to guide with the GPS, I may not exactly follow the implement.
Okay, so you're just better off the hand steer.
You're better off the hand steer, unless you have your row guidance, which is an option.
Do they have row guidance on some of those machines?
No, they are not currently running row guidance.
Okay, got it.
But row guidance is an option.
How big is the tank? Is it 350?
This one is 410.
410, oh, they increased it then.
Well, it's an option.
Oh, it's an option.
Right, and if you take the larger tank, then you have to take certain final drives, certain tire combinations, certain ground drive hybrid combinations.
To handle that type of load, okay.
You ready to drive?
Yeah, I'll take it for a spin. Sure thing.
So I'm gonna shut
my turn, guys.
I'll shut the feeder off.
Okay.
Then we'll switch spots, so if you just stand, I'll slide our
Camera. That's nice about having a big cab.
There you go.
All right, guys.
Buckle up here.
Get clicked in. All right. So I have had a little bit of time. About 2 weeks ago, I was running a 9120 and a 9230.
Yeah.
So it's familiar, but you're going to have to show me what's going on. So we're full throttle.
Yeah, we're full throttle. Let's throttle down to start with.
All right. We'll kick her back.
And then we're going to use the feeder switch.
Okay.
And that'd be the one to the right, the yellow one to the right.
This one. Okay.
And we'll just pick it up and move it forward.
Okay.
And now we've got our weight, everything's going good. Now we'll throttle up.
Okay, full throttle.
We always harvest at full throttle.
Okay.
Always.
Okay. Always in full throttle.
And then we're going to,
I'm cutting corn.
There you go.
All right, that's it. We're finding a way to grow this on our farm, I've decided. We'll haul water if we have to.
It likes water, but it doesn't like wet feet.
So. Yeah. No, this is neat. This is really cool.
All right. You need me to hang on to your camera, or what do you need me to hang on to?
If you'd like to, you can hold there's a handle down at the bottom there.
Okay.
And right now it's just on a wide angle lens. So what people see is that. And then the comments are on the left there. So, what's up, guys? Okay, so we need to go now. I'm not in automation right now.
No automation. You just drive it by hand. So we'll just sit here and wait.
We'll get up here and then I'll swing my auger out.
We'll wait and see.
Actually, we're not full yet, are we?
No.
Okay.
We're not even 3/4 full.
Okay, there we go.
So we would know that by right here. You see it says 0?
Yep.
So we're not quite 3/4 full yet. When it gets to 3/4 full, that'll say 75%. And then when we get to 100, or when we get full, that'll say 100%.
Okay.
So
there we go.
Tell us that we're full enough. So we're not 3/4 full.
Not 3/4.
These guys are full, and they're sitting waiting for the cart.
Okay.
And they could probably go a little bit farther, but it's not worth it because the next thing you know, it's overflowing.
And this field's short right here.
Yeah, and we're, you know, if we fill it too full, we go down the hill, we'll put it on the third bend.
What I hear, corn cap?
You would cap
corn.
Corn. You would cap
corn. Corn. Okay, yeah, cap corn, that's right. We're shaking those stalks. Okay.
It does give you an idea of what happens during the corn head.
Yeah.
So you can see the one stalk there in the middle is being wiggled by the gathering chain paddles.
Yep.
So if we inch up just a little bit more, it'll grab it, pull it through, and it'll take it down. So
okay.
Just nose this up just a little bit and watch that stalk right there.
Yep. Just about got it. Oh, there she's gone.
And, you know, that's the beauty of the modern machinery is it can process stalks rather quickly. Now, from a safety standpoint, you know, that's a pretty dangerous machine.
That would take your leg off and more pretty fast.
So
that's not good.
Very, very careful
yeah.
When we're doing
doing any servicing work, etc.
What type of corn head is on this combine?
This is a Case IH 4408 30-inch row corn head.
Okay. All right. And for a 7 series like this, you could run a 12?
Yeah, you could run a 12. And
okay.
We have many, many customers that use Class 7s and run 12 rows.
Okay.
And again, you know, we're picking at 4.5 to 5, but we're only using 80-some% of our engine load.
Okay.
So if we were to, you know, add 50%, maybe we wouldn't go the exact same speed. Maybe slow down a little bit, but we would still have plenty of combine to do that.
Yeah.
And yeah, everybody's got a different preference for how fast they like to pick corn.
Okay.
Some people like to pick corn at 5 or 6 miles an hour. Some people like to pick corn slower. Kind of depends on the undulations and how many washouts you have.
Yeah.
And that sort of thing. So.
Well, because like in wheat country, I mean, if we can get it in the header, we're good to go.
Absolutely.
So if the combine can take it, I can go 7 miles an hour.
Exactly.
But with corn, there's a something with the stalks, what do you call them, when they're being pulled down?
Right. So we're going to process the stalks with the stalk roll knives.
So there's probably the technology ahead, there's a limit on.
There is. Now, this particular machine has in-cab speed control over the feeder header drive.
Okay.
And right now, I've just dialed in a speed, but we can put it in automatic mode.
Okay.
And the corn head would speed up and slow down as we were moving along.
Oh, that's neat.
So just like your reel does,
yeah,
we can do that with a corn header.
Okay.
So if we just simply just yep. touch the A, and now we're going to automatic mode. Now, while we're sitting here waiting, let's just go back into the toolbox and then scroll across the bottom there.
I'll flip my camera on here.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Where do you want me to go?
Scroll over to feeder.
Feeder.
Yeah. Touch feeder. Okay. And now you see that the minimum auto feeder speed is 0.
Okay.
Okay. And the max is 5.
Oh, I see.
So let's move that min up to about 3.
Okay. Tap it.
So what we're doing here, it was,
I can do this.
You can touch anywhere in the marker.
Oh, there we go. The 3?
Yeah, we'll set. Yeah, 3 is good. And it moved the top one up to 8.
This one up to 8. Okay.
Yeah. Good. And you can use the arrow to fine tune that. All right. So what this says now is that we're in automatic mode. We're going to run the feeder at the slowest speed possible, which is 460.
Okay.
So between 0 and 3 miles an hour. And then between 3 and 8, we're going to accelerate it up to 690. So by the time we're going 8 miles an hour, it will be doing 690 RPM on the header.
Really? So yep. I didn't realize that corn heads increase and decrease. I guess that makes sense. They have to. Oh, there's our, that's a 485 Steiger.
Yep, with
1100 bushel card on it.
Yep.
That's cool.
All right, so now what we'll do is we'll make sure that we're an auto header, which we are.
Okay.
And you can.
I can start cutting again.
Yeah, you can start cutting again.
I'll put you on the wide angle here so everybody can get a. This phone's got 3 cameras on it. There we go. There's the line.
Cool.
All right.
Good. So off we go. And we'll see what kind of stock processing we get.
Now, do you want me to put this in automation?
No, I'd say for now, we'll just drive it for a little bit.
Okay, get the feel
of this. Yep, and then we'll turn the automation on.
Okay, I see.
And it looks like you're doing a good job of staying on the row, which is great for new operators. To try to feed that stalk right in the middle of the header.
It's funny because I'm not paying attention to where the stalk's going. I'm paying attention to keep the tip of my...
That's what you need to do.
What do they call the point of that?
The glider points.
The glider points. Keeping that
more affectionately known as the snoot.
The snoot.
Right. So you will hear people talk about rolling a snoot.
Is that curling it under the combine?
Curling it under, that's right.
Oh, boy, yeah.
Usually that's when you're too low and you stick it in the far side of the dip.
Okay, I bet that happens quite often.
It does, that's right.
Now, are those fiberglass, or are they...
These are plastic.
Plastic, okay.
All right, so historically, all corn head snoots were metal, and they took quite a bit of abuse.
Okay,
and
yeah.
And the plastic ones are much nicer. In fact, these, if you roll one of these, you take it in the house or shop and put it near the furnace, warm it up, it will relax, and you can kind of beat it back into
got a little bit
shape.
Of memory.
Got a little bit of memory, you got it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, are most of the corn stalks down low, or are they all the way up towards the top?
No, they're right in the middle.
Right in the middle.
Yeah, so we need to stay to the right a little bit.
Go a little bit.
Yeah, go a little bit off. Yeah, you see how it goes off center?
Yeah.
And then we don't do as good a job of picking, and we could lose either kernels or cobs.
Oh, so it's pretty crucial to stay. Yeah,
you need to stay on the row.
As center as you can.
That's right. It works the best.
Okay.
All right, so now let's swing our unload auger out.
Okay. Yeah, that's this one.
Just yep.
Click it once.
Yeah. Click the left side once.
Oh, left side. There we go. Like that.
Our grain car operator will come up alongside of us because he'll see that we've swung out our unload auger.
Slow down a little bit.
Yep,
here.
Slow down. Yep, let it process all that stuff.
There's our auger coming out.
Yeah, auger's out.
Man, Russ, you can double as a film producer, cameraman.
And my other Johnny O is coming up alongside of us there.
That was my spout. Do I need to
tip it anywhere? Yeah, no, he'll get you that way. You just stay on the row. Okay. And now you can hit the unload button.
Okay. And he'll it tips down on its own.
It does. That's right.
Oh, that's nice.
And then he'll start, he'll just follow right along with us.
Okay.
Because he knows that we're traveling somewhere around four and a half.
Okay.
So he's going to do that speed. And it's his job to stay the right distance away.
Okay.
And it's your job to make sure that you don't overrun the cart. So as the cart gets full, you may have to speed up a little bit to go in the front or in the back.
Yeah.
But right there is fine. We typically want to go just ahead of the axle.
Okay.
When we start, so we put some tongue weight on it. And then as we fill it up, we can
maybe
do
fill it. Back.
Yeah. Yeah. Not a big deal with a Steiger, but a two-wheel drive machine, if you load the back too much, you can tip them up.
So do you usually go to the front first, then go to the back?
That's what I do.
So
yes.
I speed up a little bit.
Yeah,
here,
it's okay. He'll stick with you.
Okay. Oh, it's okay.
Yeah. It can take a lot there. It can really pile it up. So.
Yeah.
All right. So then we got to look in here, and we're almost empty. So we'll maybe get to the bottom here. And then the trick is at the very, very end here, both of you got to stop at the same time.
Okay.
If we're still dumping corn when we get to the end of the row. So we don't have very far to go here. And that's the big trick.
You know,
just make sure everybody's on the same page. And I think we're going to make it because we're going to be out of corn before we get out of row. So that's great.
Are we just about done here?
I'd say you can shut
it
off.
Okay.
Yep.
And I'll wait till he gets out of it before I pull it back.
That's right. So he'll pull away.
Okay.
And he's off to the semis.
Now he's out of the way.
Yep. And then you can swing your unload auger back.
Okay.
Now, we swing the unload augers in and out as the signal to the grain cart operator that he should
signal.
That's just for him, right?
Yeah.
Keep raising your header up, please.
Oh, yes.
That's good. Very, very front of the handle, you'll have a button.
Yes.
And then you'll have a resume button on the
header
on your side.
So the button will
There you go.
Over a little bit.
There you go. Okay. Yeah, and you don't, if we were off a row, we would stop, we would back up, and then we would move over. We would not just cut across.
Yeah, I was going to say,
and
wheat, it doesn't matter.
That's right. Wheat and soybeans, same thing. And we are seeing a little bit of deer damage in here as well.
Oh, okay.
So we're getting deer walking through here, and they like to eat, but they like to eat a little bit off of every cob. Instead of just eating one cob.
They sound like like fruit fly or the bugs that eat on like strawberry patch. You know, they got to take a bite out of every strawberry patch. Yeah.
That's right.
That's funny.
So we're getting this 34 acres chewed off here pretty quick with two combines.
Good.
So.
Well, I can I'll cut to the end here, and then I can give you the seat again.
Okay.
And then I can handle that for a second, and probably shut the stream down because we're in about an hour right now.
Yeah.
Well, this has been very informative. This is fun.
And the one thing about combining that a lot of people don't realize is that once everything is working good, it's just another round.
Okay.
We just go, and it's the same thing. And the most exciting day on the farm is when nothing exciting happens.
Yeah.
I know there's been some TV shows out there where they tried to make drama happen.
Yeah,
those shows are no longer on the air because they're not very dramatic when everything goes good. So
that's exactly right. You don't want breakdowns.
No, you don't want to get stuck. You don't want breakdowns.
You especially don't want fire.
Yeah, that's true.
Is corn? Is it a fire hazard crop?
Typically, no.
Okay.
So
it doesn't really put a lot of hazardous dust that combusts.
No, absolutely not. And the stalks right now have a lot of moisture in them, even though the corn and the leaves do not. So the majority of the material that's out there is, not going to be too bad as far as fire hazard goes.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, I can see it's really got a lot laying over. Your hands steering it like I am, you can get lost in the row.
Absolutely. And these are 30-inch rows, so 30-inch rows are easier to follow than 20-inch rows.
Okay.
And there's even some people who will plant corn in 15-inch rows, and it's just a mass.
That's tight.
Yeah, it is very tight. So there's where you have to rely on your guidance systems and your row guide in order to follow those rows.
Oh, yeah.
Makes it much easier.
Okay. So what's going to happen to this combine after it gets some time? Like, say you're all done cutting, you're just going to be like a demo machine for sale at some point in time?
Yeah, so this is a pre-production unit. We built several of these. These are all on demo. This particular one is being used for internal trainings.
Okay.
And then this will be updated to the production standards.
So there's probably certain things that weren't equipped on this that they decided to put on the production models?
That is correct.
Okay.
Right. And so these will be reworked. And then they will be made available for sale.
Oh,
and we'll discount them for the number of hours that are on them, et cetera, just like any demo machine. So
they can go ahead and just probably send it out to Shelby, Montana.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. All right. Sounds good.
Well, absolutely.
I'll be waiting for her.
Okay.
That's cool. Yeah. Well, this is pretty nice. I love how big these cabs are.
Yes. I mean, so very
both,
nice.
Low profile pillars.
Comfy.
Yeah.
And we've got plenty of storage. So over his right shoulders, there's storage.
Yeah.
Over the left shoulder, there's storage. There's storage behind the seat. Yeah, they're right, meant so for creature features.
I'll tap that button. There. Oh, shift and recoil. Both of them.
Both of them.
There we go. Okay, that was fun. All right, guys, I will catch up on some donation work here. Let me buckle in here real fast. There we go. Perfect. Okay, so there's been some donations early on. If you guys are still watching, Anthony and Krusty, you guys in Wisconsin or Montana, we're in Wisconsin. Thank you for the $5, Anthony. John, B32XQ, $2.79 Canadian. Are you guys going to stop by and visit How Farms Work? I don't think so. It's not the plan. We don't have a lot of time. We're taking off tomorrow, but that would be fun to meet those guys. Let's see here. Let me go to the next one. Tony Zilinick, $5. Thanks for the great videos, Tony. I appreciate it. Thank you for the $5. That's awesome. Todd Thomas, $5. No comment. I'm just going to say, I think Todd was really thinking he wants his combine or wants to go cut corn. So we'll just put that in there for his comment. Okay. Let's see what else. We got $100 from Jacob Hoffman. Jacob, wow. Thank you. Love your videos. God bless your family and keep up the great work. Enjoy the Wisconsin harvesting lifestyle. Hey, it's beautiful out here. I love these farms. Out in Montana, our nearest farm neighbor is 8 or 9 miles away. And we just don't have these beautiful silage towers. We don't have the trees. The houses here are it's just different. You know, there's a different beauty out here that Montana doesn't have. This is fun. Well, thank you for the $100, Jacob. That's really small of you. I really appreciate it. $2 from Blackwood Stuff. Love your bids. Came to NDSCS and Millennial Farmer. Well, thank you. Those guys got good channels. They're great. Let's see. How Farms Work is in Potosi, Wisconsin. Potosi, Wisconsin.
Potosi. So Potosi is all, we're on the eastern, southeast corner of Wisconsin. And if we go straight across the state to the Mississippi River,
okay,
which is what separates Minnesota and Wisconsin, Potosi is right on the river.
Oh, so he's right on the edge.
That's right.
That's awesome. Well, thank you for the $2. Anthony Krakowski, $5 again. I haul many case of New Hollands out of that plant you're at. Oh, yeah, you're the truck driver, man. That's great. That's awesome. Well, be careful with those things. Zach's $2. No comment. Thank you, Zach. James Grisnich, $5. Can you explain again why you don't chop the corn stalks?
Too difficult to do. It consumes a lot of horsepower, and it wears things out.
So they're better off to run some kind of speed tiller or chopper over the top?
Well, you can run a crop chopper if you want, but this particular farm will use what we call a vertical tillage tool.
Vertical tillage.
And they will knock the stalks down and incorporate them into the soil, because we will no-till soybeans into this stubble next spring. And that will provide a very thick mat over the top.
Okay. Let me switch my camera here. We got some action happening. There we go. Okay. That's a good question. Excellent question, guys. All right. Well, I'll finish out this pass. I'll watch these guys dump on the go. And then I think I'm going to call the stream for you guys and end it there. It's been a lot of fun. I gotta go play on this thing. Dad's on the channel. Robert Welker, it's been a blast. CNH has hosted very well. Thank you. Yeah, that's definitely Case. It's been great. Are Case producing a new Straw Walker combine in 2019?
No.
No, not a Straw Walker.
No,
that's probably a thing of the past.
Well, for Case IH brand.
Okay.
Yep. Case IH brand, nowhere in the world produces a Straw Walker combine.
How often do you check the knives on them then? The knives, are you talking the knives on the straw chopper?
Or the knives on the corn head.
Maybe the corn head.
Yeah, so we would probably get 2 seasons out of a set of knives. We would certainly do the inspection on them. And if we saw where, obviously it's gonna depend on how many acres you pick, but we would probably get a 2 years out of a set of stock roll knives. And then we would rebuild the whole head if we wanted to keep it for the next couple of seasons.
How clean does a sample look? Well, I am not a very good indicator myself of what a clean corn sample looks. Can corn samples get pretty dirty?
Yeah, they can. Yeah, you see a bunch of cob pieces, a lot of pieces of
Okay.
The window is really difficult too because a lot of things will roll.
Yeah, the light stuff.
That's right.
I've learned that chaff always likes to blow or chatter against the window, and then when you actually dump, you look at it and go, oh, that's actually not as bad as I thought it was. Yeah. Okay. Why doesn't the farmer run green? Well, I guess he did, and he decided to switch to red. I can't answer for him, but
that's right.
Nobody can.
We're very thankful.
Yeah. No, it's worked out great for these guys because they're near the Racine
factory,
so it's easy for case guys to come out and give a hand on machines or come try out new things like this.
Yep.
Like this combine we're in, which is, if you guys are tuning in, it's the 7250. It's the latest and greatest from Case for the 7 Series coming out next year. And it's a full automation combine. If you watch the beginning of this video, you'll see. Why won't Case make a self-propelled chopper? Is that even a thing? I don't know.
It is a thing, but the CNH Industrial uses the New Holland brand to sell the self-propelled chopper.
Oh, I see. That makes sense.
Right. So
it's kind of a tricky thing between the two.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Well, the brands are set up cash grains and then livestock, and obviously a self-propelled chopper would be considered more of a livestock piece of equipment, and we do sell that in the New Holland brand.
Yeah, that makes sense. This guy says, is the light LEDs rust, and is the option the new LEDs for more visibility? Does these come with the LED option?
Well, we have LED distance lights.
Okay.
But the main stadium lights are still incandescent.
Where is the engine made? Is it Italy?
This engine is made in France.
France, okay.
But to say that is true, but the actual answer is it's a global engine.
Because
we build pieces and parts of the engines all over the world, and
okay.
then send them to an assembly plant. This particular engine happens to be assembled in France.
Okay.
We have engine assembly plants all over the world. So
that makes sense. Okay. How many bushel per acre we're running? About 2 to 250, kind of that area, or low 200s.
Yeah.
Which
for us is excellent. We'll take that.
This guy says, I build transmissions for Fiat in Indiana. Oh, well, that's
go.
Cool.
Yeah.
Nice. What size grain cart? That was an 1150, I think.
Yep.
1150 bushel, and then they've got a 750 running around, too. Come on. Okay. All right. Well, guys, it's an hour and 15-minute stream. That's probably long enough. I might go back and re-edit the stream a little bit, make it a little shorter, cut out some of the quiet stuff.
Boring parts.
Yeah, most of the time when Russ talks, I'll cut that out.
Yeah, exactly. How can anything be boring? You're picking corn. It's a beautiful day.
Well,
you got great.
Good point. He is right. I've been told, though. See, I was told that Peter from Australia was the combine guru. Everybody said there was no one better than him. But
well,
from what I hear over here, you're like the sensei to Peter. So
well, Peter does an excellent job for our dry land customers, especially where you live in Shelby, Montana.
So you would specialize in this, in corn and soybeans?
Yeah, certainly, then. Because I live here and this is the crops that I'm used to dealing with. But Peter's a good asset
good.
For us as well.
Well, that's cool.
So now what we have to do is we're looking at this corn here and we got to figure out where's our eighth row.
Oh, yeah, look at
there.
That.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So maybe
now,
our eight.
Do you like to line up with the end or the tip of your center?
Well,
you just count to the over eight and start over here.
Yeah, I just count it over eight and start here and hope that I am and right at the end.
Okay.
And guys that plant corn perfectly make it difficult for us to pick corn. So every now and then it's good to have one that's not exactly perfect.
Okay.
So that we can find the edges because we really do want to be on the edge of a planter.
Got
and
it.
You can see that I guessed right that time and we're right on the
good
corn,
deal.
So.
All right. Well, guys, I think that's going to be it. Again, thanks. It's been a fun trip. We're still enjoying our time in Wisconsin. Got a couple more things planned. I'm going to throw together a little video of our experience in what's called the Experience Center in Racine. It was a neat place to go to. We got a tour of that Magnum factory. That was fun. That was a lot of fun. I'm hoping eventually here we might get to the Grand Rapids and check out the Combine factory. That would be a blast.
Grand Island.
Grand Island, not Grand Rapids. Grand Island, yeah. Good thing for the correction. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Also, thank you guys for the donations. You guys are generous. That's awesome. And if you guys have questions regarding this machine or whatnot, you know, I can try to answer myself, or I can find out information for you. So you can always pass that along to me, and I'm sure I can find someone who's got answers for you. But yep. All right, you guys have a good one. Thank you. Take care. Have a good weekend.
Hi, everybody.
We'll catch you all later.
Thanks for riding along.